This is the one that Allah chose a cut above the rest. This is the one that Allah gave the qabuliyat to, the acceptance. Don't ask me why. This is the one that Allah chose a cut above the rest, as a result of which 1300 years have passed. 1300 years have passed, and the Siwadul A'zam has been following the fiqh of Abu Hanifa and will do so for years to come, right till the Day of Judgment. In the hundreds of millions in Pakistan, hundreds of millions in Bangladesh, hundreds of millions in Hindustan, in Turkey, in all the former Russian states of Kazakhstan, Chechnya, Azerbaijan, in China, in Iraq, in Jordan, in England, in America, in every corner of the globe, in their hundreds of millions, from laymen to great masters like who? Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayhi, who himself is worthy of a lecture. Imam Yusuf rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Tuhavi rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Zufr rahmatullahi alayhi, every one of them followed the fiqh of Abu Hanifa. You had the likes of Dawud At-Ta'i, and he was that scholar who fasted for 40 years. And my friends, he fasted with such sincerity that his own family members, his own wife and children did not know that he was fasting. Because he would take his lunch from home, and as he would leave and go wherever, he would distribute it to the fuqara and give it to the poor people. You had the great Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, who had, I would say, a near complete personality. A near complete personality. He was an all-round master. And his status with regards to the knowledge of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Usama says that the status of Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak amongst the muhaddithin, the masters of a hadith, was like the status of the Amir al-Mu'mineen amongst the people. That his status amongst the muhaddithin was like the status of a king amongst his people. You know, doesn't it ever go past your mind that this person who was the teacher of Imam Bukhari, you know, Imam Bukhari took his hadith. If you look at the chains of Bukhari, you will see in there, Haddathana ibn al-Mubarak. The man had so much knowledge of a hadith that the muhaddithin say he was, you know, his status was like, you know, the Amir al-Mu'mineen. Why would he follow the fiqh of Abu Hanifa? You had Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Qattan, Imam al-Jarh wa al-Ta'dil. You know, today my young friends amongst themselves will fight and argue about, oh, this hadith is not seen, this hadith is not seen. My friends, Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Qattan was the one that laid down the foundations of this science. He laid down the foundations of this science. And Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Qattan was a Hanafi. And his knowledge with regards to hadith, nobody doubts that the great Ahmad ibn Hanbal had knowledge of a hadith. If you just look at the musnad of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, you'll realize how much hadith this man knew. Now just his musnad, he chose from a few hundred thousand hadith. So Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy upon him, he says, I swear by Allah, I have never seen any man like Yahya ibn Sa'id al-Qattan when it came to the knowledge of a hadith, when it came to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Again, he was a Hanafi, he followed the fiqh of Abu Hanifa. You had Makki ibn Ibrahim. Who was Makki ibn Ibrahim? If you look at the sunnahs in Bukhari, you will find out that he was one of the teachers of Bukhari. One of the teachers of Imam Bukhari. And if you look at the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari, you will see in there The Imam Bukhari in his Sahih has 22 Thulathiyat. Thulathiyat are those hadith in which between Imam Bukhari and our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are only 3 links. The shorter the link, as long as it is authentic, the better the hadith. And out of these 22 Thulathiyat, 11 of them, half of them, Imam Bukhari has related to the sanad and chain of Makki ibn Ibrahim, who followed the fiqh of Abu Hanifa. You had Yahya ibn Ma'in, Imam al-Jarh wa Ta'dil, who we can consider as another one who laid down the foundation of this science of authentic hadiths. He was a Hanafi. He was that muhaddith that he inherited 1,050,000 dirhams. He spent every penny that he inherited from his father in acquiring the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so much so that this man had to sell his own slippers just to purchase paper to write down the hadith of Rasulullah. And then, my friends, the day came in which he said, with these very own hands, I wrote down 1,000,000 hadith. He was the teacher of not just Imam Bukhari. He was the teacher of Imam Bukhari. He was the teacher of Imam Muslim. He was the teacher of Imam Abu Dawud. And he was the teacher of the great Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah. And he followed the fiqh of Abu Hanifa. But okay, when he died, he was given this honor that he was carried on exactly the same stretcher on which our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he died, was carried on. And the people that were walking around him, this is what was coming out from their mouths. Haza Azzab an Rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam al-Kizb. Okay, this is the man that would remove the lies that have been attributed to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, this is an exhaustive list. I can spend the entire night just mentioning name after name after name after name. From laymen to great masters followed the fiqh of Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. And this is something from Allah. Nobody can do anything about this. You know, whether it pleases them or whether it displeases them. Whether they agree with this or whether they disagree with this. You know, hundreds of years ago, commentating on the hadith, لا تقوم الساعة حتى يظهر العلم, Hassan ibn Sulaiman rahimullah said, commentating on the hadith, the final hour will not take place till knowledge will appear. Hassan ibn Sulaiman said hundreds of years ago, commentating on this hadith, that the knowledge referred to in this hadith is none other than the knowledge of Abu Hanifa and his companions. Khalf ibn Ayyub rahimullah, hundreds of years ago, this is what he said. He said, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the knowledge directly from Allah, the Sahaba from him, the Tabi'een from them, and then it was Abu Hanifa and his companions that took the knowledge from the senior Tabi'een, whether people agree with this or whether people disagree with this. Now, they said this hundreds of years ago. My friends, if somebody could have raised an objection hundreds of years ago, what can you say in this day and age when this is what the Siwadul A'zam has witnessed for the last 1300 years? For the last 1300 years, this is what the Siwadul A'zam, the majority of the Ummah, has witnessed. And if anyone cannot see this, then my friends, there is no cure for blindness and there is no cure for ignorance. And who was this man that Allah gave the acceptance? Who was this man? Which era was he from? That era which our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself praised. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, خَيْرُ الْقُرُونِ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. The best people. The best people are the people of my time, the companions. Then, who are the best people? They're the Tabi'een, those that come thereafter. And after the Tabi'een, it's the Atba'u Tabi'een, those that come after the Tabi'een. Out of the 4 Imams, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Malik, and Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahumullah ajma'een, Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi was the only one that was a tabi'i. And not only was he a tabi'i, he was from a special categories of tabi'is regarding which the Quran says, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَأُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ أَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوءًا. And those that follow the former from amongst the Muhajirin and Ansar with sincerity, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ أَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوءًا. Allah is pleased with them and they with Allah. And Allah has prepared for them gardens under which rivers flow, in which they will remain forever and ever. ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. That is the supreme, that is the ultimate success. What can be the status of such an individual that belongs to a group regarding which Allah is saying, Allah is pleased with them and they with Allah. You know, logic, you know, the akal can't understand this thing called acceptance. The akal can't understand things like acceptance. You know, 1 minute Bishr al-Hafi is taking intoxicants. And look up next minute where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes him. Allah knows the heart. He knows what's inside there. He knows what type of a person you are. Look at Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. Look how Allah brought him. And look how Allah wanted to make him be the person to elevate the kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. In his early days, born in the 80th year of Hijrah in Kufa, in his early days, Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi was a businessman. Yet if you study the biographies of great muhaddithin, you will see that in general, many of them had this early start in life. And they began to seek knowledge at a very young age. And here you have, according to one narration, Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi was around 20 years of age, he was still in business. This is when Allah honored him through Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi, and he began to seek knowledge. Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi, Imam Abu Hanifa himself relates that one day I was walking and Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi was seated and he called me. He called me and said, "Oh Noman, where are you going? Who do you regularly visit?" So Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi mentioned a person in the marketplace. So Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi said to him, "No, I'm not referring to this. Who do you regularly visit with regards to the ulama? And who do you benefit from?" Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi said, "Look, my visits to the ulama are very limited." Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi said to him, "Ya Nu'man, don't do this. I can see signs of intelligence inside you." Now Allah gives basirat to his friends. So he said to him, "I can see signs of intelligence, don't do this. Stay in the company of the ulama and seek knowledge." Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi says, from that day his words had such an impact upon me. His words had such an impact upon me that from that day I left the marketplace and I came and began to sit in the company of ulama and seek knowledge. And he began with ilmul kalam, scholastic theology. And because he was naturally gifted in such a short time, he mastered this science so much so that without a shadow of doubt, he was the most knowledgeable person in his time with regards to the ilmul kalam. With regards to scholastic theology. He says that people began to look up to me in honor with regards to this science. And Allah blessed me with regards to the science of debate that nobody could stand before me. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted him to use him for something else. So what happens one day, he's sitting with his friends close to the gatherings of the great Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman, one of the greatest scholars of Iraq at the time. And a woman came to him and asked him a simple question. And the question with regards to, how do you give talaq according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? And now Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi didn't know the answer. So he said, "I felt ashamed and I lowered my head. And I said to this woman, Ki Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman is there, go ask him. But please on your return come and tell me the answer." She went, got the answer, and on return told Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. He says, from that day onwards, I said to myself, there is no need for scholastic theology, no need for ilm al-kalam. And he took his shoes and came and sat in the gatherings of the great Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman. And he says, what would happen in the gatherings is, Imam Hamad would relate the masail. Next day he would repeat them. And he says, I would memorize everything while my friends would forget. Now as a result of this, that my not forgetting anything, Imam Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman instructed all the other people that only Abu Hanifa rahimahullah is allowed to sit directly opposite me and no one else. And he sat in his gathering for 20 years. Today, my friends, it's the era of the internet where everyone's, you know, a do-it-yourself scholar. Do you understand? Pick up any book and give fatwa as you like. You know, mocking the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will not find one scholar out of the Salaf al-Saliheen that did not spend years on end in the company of great, great scholars to acquire this nur, this light. Not one. And he sat in his gathering for 20 years, my friends, 20 years. So much so that without a shadow of doubt, he broke the courage of his nearest rivals and without doubt was the most knowledgeable person of his time. You know, and after acquiring so much knowledge, we acquired just a bit and all of a sudden can't wait to give an answer or express an opinion even when we're not asked. And here, after acquiring so much knowledge, do you understand? And feeling the responsibility that comes with knowledge, not to just give answers like this without knowing the answers. Fearing this, Imam Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi chose seclusion. He chose seclusion. Till one night he saw our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a dream. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, O Abu Hanifa, Allah has not created you for seclusion. Allah has created you to revive my sunnah. When he received this glad tiding from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only then, from that day onwards, did the days of Abu Hanifa, they were to revive the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to derive masail from the Quran and sunnah, and the nights of Abu Hanifa were for seclusion. Allah had blessed him so much, that there was no parallel, you can't give another example. Allah had blessed him so much that from the top of his head, spur of a moment, he could solve what great, great muhaddithin and great, great scholars could not solve.